Now we have Professor Alok John sir, and he is going to share his screen with us. Alok sir, are you listening properly?
Yeah, I can listen. So the only thing is, I would prefer speaking itself.
Okay.
Since I find it a little difficult, and I would like to go with the flow. A very warm good afternoon to the August gathering here. My gratitude to the Honorable Principal Dr. Sunil Pahwa and Madam Subhadra Pandey, the Managing Secretary for Siksha Mandal, the entire faculty members of GS College Jabalpur, Professor Ankit Khare, Dr. Ashish Mishra. My gratitude to you, all of you, and warm greetings from Patna Women's College.
Thank you, sir.
I would like to begin with from where Professor Bajaj had left. The question is, we are discussing that higher academic institutions, we should focus on why there is a lack of such highly qualified professionals in higher educations. Because what I understand with my, because I must first confess that I'm too small fry in front of the two respectable speakers today. But whatever little experience I gathered, I found that there is a hierarchical difference within the Indian academic system, Indian academic bodies concerned. So if we are expecting an highly qualified HR graduate, I'm sure that it would be considered as a non-teaching personnel rather than a faculty member with certain qualifications as per the existing norms. So it is like this. In general, if we talk about any higher academic systems, standalone institutions, IIMs, if you see, so there is a big difference between the teaching faculty members and non-teaching. So that line of difference is where, you know, that creates this difference. You know, I should, this is also one of my observation, that even top IIMs also, non-teaching faculty, the staff members are not very competent enough. So it is kind of a pandemony that institution teaching management to others have failed to, you know, teach their staff itself to manage themselves or to work in a very proper or equipped definition in which they prepare their students to work in the other organizations. So this is one loophole or the bottom line where the institution should start functioning on. Capacity building to the faculty members, that they have to do it, that they cannot survive without doing it. But the capacity building of the non-teaching staff members, make them highly competent. And that kind of a culture has to be developed in which the coexistence has to be created. So that is one thing as one of the HR practices institutions should now come up. In the West, of course, there are positions of research associates, there are positions of teaching associates, there may be positions of executive assistants to the directors. So we can just imagine, you know, if we compare the kind of people working in the institutions of Indian institutions, we can just compare the differences and see. So how will the quality or the output come if our staff members are not trained, if our staff members are not empowered? So that is one thing. Now coming to this point of where COVID situation has occurred. Can you see the PPT, sir? Hello? Hello? Yes. So now we have to focus on the emerging trends of higher education sector. So higher education in the Indian scenario has seen a tremendous growth. Nooks and corners, there are almost, if I see, there are 22 or 21 IIMs functioning. So across every 5 hours or 6 hours difference, there is an Indian Institute of Management, there is an Indian Institute of Technology. So that growth itself has been, that benchmark has been set by the government, followed by the private practitioners. So tremendous growth of institutions mushrooming here and there. So now the enterprise having a business and orientation, like the businesses have to work, the higher education also have to start functioning in a business model. They have to function as an enterprise function because the competition is fierce. Survival of the fittest is fierce. That is very important for private players. So if we talk about COVID scenario, this is once in a lifetime event, perhaps once in a century event that we have never faced before. And this sector of the economy that are most vulnerable and are going to be disruptive and are, that has never seen such disruption in the last 50 to 100 years. Of course, we have seen such kind of disruptive changes in healthcare sector, but education sector is such that has fundamentally never seen such kind of a disruption. It was always a chalk and duster position wherever it was. So we have taught the educated people the same way as we used to do it 100 years before. So what I was talking was, we have taught the educated people same way as we used to do in very rudimentary system, 100 years of same process, same functions. So that has borne a very huge cost on the infrastructures, because we have paid less focus on the human capital and paid more focus on creating state-of-the-art, world-class infrastructures. So these facilities, infrastructure facilities, dedicated faculty across functional lines, disciplines are missing. So, and all of a sudden, because of this COVID, we have seen one change that has risen in online education. So which, of course, many faculties have not dealt with. There is going to be a huge change in what the education is going to offer in the next decade, because the demand for certain disciplines is going to be, it should lose their existence, and demand for certain courses will give rise because of this global pandemic. It is going to be very important for the university and institutions to be more flexible and adaptable in the way they deploy their resources. So this COVID pandemic has brought a sea change which we never experienced before, and hopefully we are never going to experience this again. So what it has exposed is the vulnerability that our academic institution is possessing right now, and that is an high operating leverages and lots of fixed assets, which of course in down the lane it will go wasted. So we look at any standard academic institution, what we see is lots of building coming up, parking spaces, administrative supports, residential complexes, dining halls, dorms. But do we really think that these are of any use at this present scenario where we are all locked down at our home? Yes, because we have now the focus has to be on developing the human capital. Alas, this infrastructures and the budgetary concerns that an institution possesses on their various infrastructures, human capital has very limited or a negligible amount of investments in it. So now the high time is that institutions should come up to develop its human capital, focus on investing on them. So in the last decade, academic institutions were responsible for higher educations with interesting challenges. It is in their search for strategies to rationalize costs and cope with budgetary constraints while overcoming competition from the increasing growth of privately owned and managed institutions of higher learning. Traditional state-administered institutions are rethinking the manner in which higher education could be organized, accredited, funded, and delivered. So now, focusing on the upliftment of the faculty members, higher education not focused on the empowering them through e-content. Very few faculty members are able to, you know, conduct classes, organize webinars, organize conferences, academic council meetings. They are very, you know, the fear of change is there in them. So I think a kind of sensitization has to be, you know, given to them. That can only happen when the management empowers them through various kinds of resources. It may be providing them with a laptop facility. It may be providing them with a data pack. Such kind of empowerment system has to be inculcated so that, you know, staff, so the faculty members can adapt to this changing environment. Then, of course, faculty members should also be empowered to adopt to various government practices. There's something called Technical Education Quality Improvement Program. So institutions should enable themselves to adopt these programs which are offered by the AICT, SWIAM courses. So it is, I was just going through one data that many institutions, like over 25 lakh of registrations have occurred in 60 countries availing the SWIAM and other online learning platforms developed under the Digital India programs. So an institution can, as an HR practices for empowerment, ask their faculty members to undergo such kind of courses. The videos of SWIAM Prabha DTS channel has been viewed for about 50,000 people every day. So such kind of things are emerging because of this lockdown issue. The potential for e-learning and other technological advances could be gainfully exploited by the academic institutions to enhance both their research as well as richness of service delivery during this COVID pandemic. Yes, people will resist change, but we have to understand the need and importance of it. There was a situation which occurred to the teaching faculty here at Women's College. So the Indian education system, we had inculcated a sense of innovation, development. Now that every day we are having some webinar or the other, through which that also happens that if certain department has conducted that webinar very effectively, it's a kind of a competitive, sense of competition arises from other departments that they should also organize such kind of events and, you know, gain that kind of goodwill. So such kind of activities usually empower the faculty members. Apart from that, I would also focus on certain news which of course was very encouraging. That one news came as downsizing or whereby private institutions were following this practice that they were not paying their faculty members because of the lockdown, to an extent that the AICT chairman had to issue a letter, advisory that, you know, the institution should pay to the faculty members. The Apex Court, our Supreme Court, disposes a plea of private college students to get free relief because, you know, ultimately they said that from where the colleges will get salary to their employees. So such kind of initiatives have been taken by the government. The private sector institutions have to, because government sector institutions are adopting this policy of salary payment, wage payment. Of course, it may differ from state to state. But if you talk about the central government institutions, of course, those norms are there. But where this hindrance is, because is hindrance of the private institutions, the private players. So they have to basically follow this goodwill, the sense of brotherly, we can call it as, you know, we were doing a study on servant leadership. They can follow certain strategies of, Das Bhava, that Bhav has to come. You know, if the faculty has served you, now it is a position, that is a good opportunity for the institutions to give them in return. And there are other HR practices also that institutions should adopt. If a certain faculty member is ill during the COVID time, extend as many as support that you can do to the faculty member. Not only faculty members, HR also includes the student aspects as well. So my question is, if so many online classes are happening, there are students who are there in the bottom of pyramid, in the periphery. So we have to think about that, because getting data every day, it is a kind of additional cost to their families. So academic institutions have to think on that front as well, because we, and the other day, as we are all competent, we can deliver courses online. But we have to think from the students' point of view also, especially those, you know, who come from rural sectors or who are from the periphery, to ensure that they have a laptop, they have a particular data. So, of course, online teaching, like Honorable Principal Sir was saying, it has certain kinds of constraints. But as an HR practices, as an academic leader, the institutions have to come with their solutions to undertake such kind of problems which arises due to it. So, and thereafter, I think there are other things also, like inculcating the strategic leadership in terms of promoting e-governance to their various functions of the administration. And once they do, they also regain their, as per their accreditation systems, if they are they're going for NAC accreditations, they're going for NB accreditations, that also materializes. But in again, this is the right position to start with all kinds of best practices that an academic institution should adopt to. So with this, I would like to conclude my session deliberation. Ashish sir, over to
you. Thank you. Thank you, Alok sir. Thank you very much. And you have put up and include really the very relevant elements in your discussion, that the HR practices. It's a reality that we are paying a lot in constructing the infrastructural facilities in the higher education buildings and institutions, rather than to pay more on HR side. So that is the backbone of any organization, is the faculty and the human resource of that organization. So of course, as you told, that we should develop human capital as rather than to develop another capitals. Thank you very much, John sir. Thank you very much.